Tell us about the 1988 radiocarbon dating. And to me, it sounds like with all this smoke and fire, and you know what? They may have gotten the wrong pieces, but tell me about this.
Well, okay. It's kind of interesting. In 78, we did our thing. We came back. We published our work by 1981, 82. All of our work was published in peer-reviewed scientific journals. All of the evidence at that moment in time was pointing towards authenticity. And we're talking hundreds of different tests. And everything was leading towards authenticity. Even our own team had been involved in trying to get the authorities to permit radiocarbon dating. Ultimately, in 1988, radiocarbon was permitted. Dating was permitted. Our team had no involvement in that, even though we wanted to. We were sort of excluded from that. The three laboratories were chosen. A special protocol was developed over a series of meetings in Turin by the experts from the three laboratories, actually from seven laboratories originally. Sort of at the last minute, that protocol was set aside. They went from seven labs down to three labs only. Each lab was supposed to do a chemical analysis of the samples before they were burnt and destroyed in the radiocarbon dating process. None of the three labs did any chemical analysis. Even though it was billed as a blind study, the Turin authorities could find no other herringbone-woven samples to use as controls. So when they opened the samples, there was only one herringbone-woven sample. Obviously, that was the shroud, so it really wasn't a blind study. They knew exactly which sample the shroud was from. Anyway, they date it, and the results come out some months later, and the results say the shroud is medieval from either between 1260 and 1320, I believe, were the dates.
With a 95% certainty, they say this, right?
Exactly. So here we have basically one test performed three times. They took one small sample from one corner. One of the kind of ironic observations, once they got the shroud opened and unveiled and they were ready to cut a piece, they stood over it for an hour and a half sort of debating where the sample should be taken. Now, when I consider the preparation that our team spent a year and a half before we ever went to Turin planning what we were going to do, this seemed sort of ill-advised to not know where you're going to take a sample from and argue about it as you stand over the cloth. They ultimately took it from a corner. They took a small piece off this corner. They cut it in thirds, divided it. Actually, they divided it in half and then put half aside, took the other half, divided that in thirds, and gave it to the three labs. Several months later, we get the radiocarbon date. At that point in time, it was kind of ironic. There's a very famous photograph of the three scientists representing the three labs sitting in front of a blackboard with 1260 to 1390 exclamation point. Not exactly the way you were used to seeing scientists reveal their scientific data, but it sort of was a dog and pony show. And so they make this revelation that the shroud is medieval, can't be any older than 1260 period. And those of us who had been studying the shroud all these years knew about an illuminated Hungarian manuscript that was done in 1191. It's called the Prey Manuscript. Still exists in Hungary today. And it's got an illustration. An illuminated page of that manuscript shows a herringbone woven cloth with the image of Jesus being wrapped into this cloth. It shows a set of the L-shaped burn holes I alluded to earlier. So obviously this monk who did this illumination had seen the shroud, and the reason he included those L-shaped burn holes was they were the darkest and most prominent and visible thing on the shroud before the 1532 fire that put all the burns into it that we see today. So we have this. Also, that depiction of Jesus laying in that cloth in the illuminated manuscript shows him nude, which was unheard of in any medieval, Renaissance, or even modern art. There's always a modesty cloth or something wrapped around Jesus. So we know that this manuscript is 70 years earlier than the earlier possible date given by the carbon dating. So right away, those of us who knew about it said, well, there's got to be something wrong here. Well, about 8 or 10 years went by, and virtually everything about the shroud stopped. All the research, everybody just sort of was dumbfounded by this, because remember, all the previous evidence was pointing towards authenticity.
Right.
Now, the irony of it all, I think, more than anything else, is here we have one test done, not necessarily even according to their own protocol, and suddenly that one test is powerful enough to throw away all the other evidence and discard that and just say, okay, well, this proves it's a fake. To me, there's something not right about that. And what's not right is you cannot deny the other evidence that shows that it's not a medieval forgery. It's, to me, sort of ironic that it came out to be a medieval date, since all the skeptics had always argued that it was medieval. So why did a radiocarbon date come back? Well, for years after the radiocarbon dating, there were researchers proposing reasons why. One was that there was a bioplastic coating on the cloth that skewed the date. Others was the fact that it had been burned in the fire, and that might have skewed the date. None of those really held true, and most of them were just set aside by the scientific community because they just didn't, you know, have any veracity. It wasn't until 2000 that two researchers presented a paper at a conference in Italy in which they talked about the sampled area that was used for the radiocarbon dating. There were photographs made of those sampled areas by the laboratories, and these two researchers, Joe Marino and Sue Benford, obtained a set of the photographs. And Sue got the idea, just sort of came to her, that she should take these photographs to textile experts and see what they have to say. She didn't tell them it was the Shroud or anything else. They just showed them the three different textiles.
Just brought it. Okay.
Each textile expert, when they examined these closely, looked up and said, well, you know, this is a linen piece of cloth, but it's been rewoven. So when she got that the first time, she thought, well, we'll see what the others have to say.
Right.
Each of the three textile experts all said the same thing. There is evidence of a very careful reweaving in this sample area. Well, Benford Marino presented this paper, and their theory was that that corner had been rewoven or repaired at some point in history. Not a documented repair, not anything as dramatic as a fire where the repairs were obviously needed, but just a sort of a preventive maintenance. Right next to that area, a big piece had been cut out, probably by the Savoy family, either to give away or sell as relics. And when you take a woven cloth and you cut a piece out of it, it starts to unravel right away. So there is some belief that this corner was rewoven. Well, I published their paper on Shroud.com. And Ray Rogers, the chemist from Los Alamos that was head of the chemistry on the STIRP team, called me up and read me the Riot Act. He said, why are you publishing this stuff on your website? These people aren't scientists. They're the lunatic fringe. Why are you putting this garbage up there? And I said, Ray, they went to three independent textile experts. They followed the scientific method. And you don't have to have a string of initials after your name to do good science. And I felt that it was good enough. Well, he said, I'm going to prove them wrong. And he happened to have some samples that were taken from immediately adjacent that radiocarbon sampled area. And he went back and he called me about an hour and a half later, very quiet and muted and no longer yelling at me, and telling me that he thought maybe they were right, because he found, by doing some quick chemical analysis, that there was not only cotton interwoven in that area, but dye had been applied after the reweaving that was only on the surface, where when you remove one fiber where that had dye on it, the fiber underneath didn't have dye. You could see it had been applied then after the fact. And he said that chemically he could identify the dye as a rose madder dye from the madder root plant. And he said, I think maybe they're right. And he was shocked. Well, he knew that he couldn't base his science on just the samples that he'd had. They were somewhat in question. So he requested and received a piece of the actual reserve sample that had been cut for carbon dating, and he found exactly the same thing in that sample, evidence of reweaving, evidence of retouching, if you will. And why was cotton interwoven when the rest of the shroud didn't have cotton? Well, cotton takes dye a whole lot easier than the waxy outer surface of linen. Much easier to dye cotton, and we all wear Levi's all the time. They, you know how they take the dye very easily. That kind of material was there. Rogers then did an intense analysis on the real sample from the radiocarbon corner, did the analysis, and his data was published in Thermochemica Acta, one of the finest chemistry journals in the world. It went through 7 months of peer review before they agreed to publish that article. So there, in my opinion, is the closest thing to a scientific answer for what might have gone wrong. And it's a simple, you don't need to be a scientist kind of a solution. They chose a sample that was not representative. That's a huge piece of cloth. And they took one little sample from one little corner, and based on that alone, they declared the whole thing a fake. So now there's another theory that John Jackson, who was co-founder of our team, has proposed in more recent years. He does not agree with Rogers' conclusions. John's theory is that the carbon monoxide in the air reacted with the linen and could have skewed the date. Exactly. He is working with Dr. Ramsey at the Oxford Laboratory, one of the three laboratories that actually performed the carbon dating analysis on the Shroud. And so they're testing Dr. Jackson's theory, and we don't have any results from that yet, so we don't know if John's theory is, is viable, if it's been proven right or wrong yet. But that's another possibility that has not yet been either set aside or proven or whatever. They're still doing the work on that. So what we have, though, is a lot of evidence. As a matter of fact, there's a 60-page article on Shroud.com written by Joe Marino and another scientist who collated and collected all the evidence that indicated a questionable nature of this corner, and it totaled 60 pages. So there is a huge amount of evidence showing something anomalous or different about that corner than the rest of the Shroud. And I think that's the most logical explanation so far until we hear the results of Dr. Jackson's theory.
What about DNA testing? Can they test the blood, or
well,
is it just too degraded?
There was a DNA test done in 1995 at the University of Health Sciences in San Antonio, Texas. The sample that had been provided came from Dr. Garza Valdez, a man who had obtained the sample, and he was the man who proposed the theory of the bioplastic coating that was later proven incorrect. He took this sample to a gentleman, to a doctor there, a scientist there, and they did a DNA analysis, and they determined male human DNA, but so degraded that no profile could ever be taken, and they could never get a complete profile because it's so old and degraded. Interestingly enough, because that sample was never authorized for a DNA analysis test, the Turin authorities demanded the sample be returned and said that they could never stand by the results of this set of tests because they'd never authorized them. Interestingly enough, though, we know that it was a legitimate and authentic sample of the Shroud, or they wouldn't have demanded its return. So, I mean, in other words, if they said, well, that's not really from the Shroud, they wouldn't have demanded that it be returned to them. So I personally believe that the DNA, as I said earlier, is probably not going to be a very reliable test from the Shroud, mainly because my DNA is on it, Madame Fleury-Lemberg's DNA is on it from her handling of it in 2002, and anybody else who's touched it, breathed on it, leaned over it in the last 700 to 2,000 years will have some of their DNA on that cloth.
So we can't clone Jesus, can we?
Well, you know, I've heard this many times, and look, you can't clone someone from an incomplete DNA profile. You know, you've only got a few segments of DNA there that are still viable at all.
There's another novel there for you.
Well, there is.
Well, we'll be back in a moment. We'll continue chatting, and then we'll take phone calls next hour on Coast to Coast AM.